With only 2 weeks to go till our 1,000th week of reporting amateur radio and technology news, you are with This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. This is edition number 997, with a release and air date of Saturday, April 7th, 2018. Please stand by to take the feed to air following the cue tone. Welcome. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service of the air. Here's the stories that are trending as we come to air this week. More than 30,000 new hams joined our ranks last year through more than 7,000 VE sessions. We will have all the numbers for you. The High Frequency Active Auroral Research Project, or HAARP, will be active again during April. The ARRL Public Relations Committee gets new leadership and updated missions and goals. The ARRL Chief Executive Officer comes aboard facing new challenges and a lot of changes. Meanwhile, the League is looking for its next CEO. Are you interested? We will tell you how to apply. We will have an update on the year-long grid chase contest and tell you about the first transatlantic contact on 2200 meters. These headline stories will come to you in a moment along with this week's special features. Our technology reporter, Leo Laporte, W6TWT, discusses a brand new, fast, and secure DNS service you can use. And we are here. And the results of a new study on cell phone radiation. Australia's own Ono Vent Shop, VK6FLAB, discusses you and the International Amateur Radio Union. Our own amateur radio historian, Bill Continelli, W2XOY, will be here with another edition of Amateur Radio History Headlines. And something brand new, our own Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, will begin a four-part series on operating ham radio while you're aboard a train, as he takes us on the rails. Plus, we will have the first of a two-part talk on continuous wave as Lewis Coe, W9CNY, discusses the history of Morse code. That and a lot more is straight ahead as edition number 997 of North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service, This Week in Amateur Radio, takes to the air right now. Reporting from our headquarters studio facility here in beautiful downtown Albany, New York, I'm W2XBS.
And reporting from our news bureau in Syracuse, New York, where Mother Nature says, spring? You don't need any spring. I'm Chris Perrine, KB2FAF.
And reporting from New York's Catskill Mountains, where there's snow and the robins this morning, I'm Don Hulick, K2ATJ.
Reporting from the K9IG News Bureau in Franklin, Indiana, where it won't quit snowing, I'm Amy Jo Clarke.
30 minutes of solid amateur radio news begins now.
Our top story this week comes from the ARRL, who says that for the fourth year in a row, more than 30,000 new licensees join the amateur radio ranks, and the ARRL Volunteer Examiner Coordinator System conducted more than 7,000 amateur radio exam sessions, serving some 35,350 candidates for a new or upgraded license. Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, is standing by at League headquarters with more details on this late-breaking story.
At the end of December 2017, the U.S. amateur radio population stood at 748,136. At nearly 378,000 amateurs, technician licensees represented the largest segment, with generals at 174,206,000, amateur extra at 145,34,000, advanced at 41,938,000, and novice at 9,056 trailing. Licensee numbers showed continued growth across all classes except advanced and novice, which the FCC no longer issues. Accordingly, those numbers continue to drop. Despite the optimistic influx of 32,196 newcomers last year, the net growth of 5,349, or about 0.72% over December 2016, reflects some 27,000 expired or canceled licenses in the FCC database over the past year. I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX.
I'm hopeful that the number of new licensees will be more than 30,000 at the end of this year, ARRL VEC Manager Maria Soma, AB1FM, said. I would love to see this trend continue. Soma said topping the 7,000 mark in ARRL VEC-sponsored exam sessions since 2014 was an important milestone for amateur radio. In 2017, the ARRL VEC administered 7,075 sessions. In making the case for changes to the entry-level license, the ARRL Board Entry-Level License Committee referred to the large number of baby boomers, roughly born between 1945 and 1965, who will soon be aging off the licensee rolls. The committee predicted the likelihood of a significant decline in the number of hams unless we take steps to reverse it. Soma said that in addition to exam session administration, ARRL VEC also processed and electronically transmitted 8,765 address changes and license renewals to the FCC for the ARRL members in 2017. This free service to members continues to be a strong draw, she said. She further pointed out that as one of three FCC-authorized club stations, call sign administrators, ARRL VEC processed and transmitted 1,761 club license applications for the FCC in 2017, of which 338 were for new club licenses. The number of amateur radio license upgrades was 9,576 in 2017, continuing a slight downward trend over the past 10 years.
Alaska's Superpower High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program, or HAARP, with transmitters in Gakona, Alaska, will fire up again for the spring research campaign, April 6th through the 14th. For more details on the upcoming research, we go to Carla Pereira at League Headquarters.
University of Alaska Fairbanks Space Physics Group researcher and HAARP Chief Scientist Chris Fallon, KO3WX, told ARRL that more than 40 hours of externally funded experiments are in the queue. For his part, Fallon said he still has some time remaining on his National Science Foundation grant, but added that this is a tough time of year and a tough year of the solar cycle for such experiments. He said, quote, "It will not be dark enough in Gakona, Alaska, to observe artificial airglow emissions until 10 p.m. at the beginning of the campaign and 10:30 p.m. at the end of the campaign, due to the rapidly lengthening days in the land of midnight sun," close quote.
Scientists from U.S. universities and government labs will explore the physics of scintillations, magnetic field-aligned plasma irregularities, artificial and natural atmospheric airglow, stimulated electromagnetic emissions, plasma waves, and radio-enhanced ionization, Fallon said. The HAARP transmitter is still at 80% net power, but by summer we expect to have the final column of transmitters restored, bringing the array back to 100%. Fallon said that due to weakening solar activity, the critical frequency of the ionosphere's F2 layer is relatively low during the day, peaking at a little more than 4 MHz above Gakona in the late afternoon and falling rapidly in the evening. This limits the time available for experiments, since airglow is usually only created when the HAARP transmission frequency is near or below FO2, Fallon explained. The lower limit for the HAARP transmitter is approximately 2.7 MHz, so we can only expect perhaps 30 minutes or less of usable airglow experiment time each day. Fallon said he's considering his options and plans to continue bundling amplitude modulations in the airglow experiments of interest to hams. His previous airglow experiments were accompanied by tones and music to illustrate the Luxembourg effect and slow scan TV images in the SCOTY 1 format. In future experiments, I want to try sending text and images using one of the MFSK modes, Fallon told ARRL. Several hams have requested that I try the smoking hot FT8 mode with HAARP, since that is a mode primarily designed for two-way contacts and which makes use of time synchronization to help achieve amazing efficiency. It's not yet clear to me how to best do this with HAARP, which is currently has no receive capability. Fallon said he has to be at UAF for most of April, but will be at HAARP towards the end. He plans to tweet selected transmitter frequencies and other information throughout the campaign from his personal Twitter page. HAARP's official Twitter page will share photos and other information of general interest, such as what HAARP dog is up to, said Fallon. The operation of the HAARP research facility was transferred from the U.S. Air Force to the University of Alaska in Fairbanks in 2015.
You're listening to North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, distributed worldwide at twiar.net.
The ARRL Public Relations Committee is undergoing some changes under the leadership of new committee chair Steve Sid Caesar, NH7C, with ARRL Board Liaison and Roanoke Division Vice Director Bill Maureen, N2COP, and ARRL Communications Manager David Isker. An ARRL Life member who has served on the PR committee for about 3 years, Caesar succeeds Scott Westerman, W9WSW, as chair. The mission and goals for 2018 have been set. Caesar, Maureen, and Isker are putting together a team that will focus on empowering ARRL Public Information Officers, or PIOs, and Public Information Coordinators by giving them better tools and resources to reach out to traditional media outlets and social media and to continue to raise the visibility of amateur radio. These will include a revamped Contact e-newsletter that will offer tips, suggestions, and best practices for PIOs and PICs, a re-energized PR reflector to share success stories and examples of what works and what doesn't in pitching media outlets, and a 2018 events calendar to give PIOs and PICs a hook for drawing media attention to amateur radio. In addition, social media page guidelines are being developed to leverage coverage to communities both within and outside of amateur radio. Caesar, the new PR committee chair, serves as the chief of Bureau of Indian Affairs Emergency Management in the U.S. Department of the Interior. Previously, Caesar served as the state, local, tribal, and territorial emergency manager at the Department of the Interior's Office of Emergency Management in Washington, D.C. His 34-year public safety and emergency management career has also included experience in various areas of public safety. He is an active sky-worn volunteer in the Washington, D.C. area and an active contester and member of the Potomac Valley Radio Club. During the run-up to ARRL's National Parks on the Air operating event, Caesar assisted in coordinating with the National Park Service. Maureen returns to the PR committee after a three-year hiatus. With more than 30 years as an independent financial planner, Maureen worked during and after college as a TV news producer in Boston, New York, and Washington, D.C. He has served as an ARRL PIO, North Carolina Section PIC, and as North Carolina Section Manager. Maureen was previously on the PR committee from 2004 until 2014, serving as chairman for three of those years. He is the 2001 winner of ARRL's Philip J. McGann Silver Antenna Award for Outstanding Public Relations on behalf of amateur radio. Other PR committee members include committee stalwart Angel Santana, WP3GW, Andy Maluzzi, KK4LWR, a Walt Disney Parks and Resorts system engineer and a University of Florida alumnus who is an active leader of the ARRL's College Amateur Radio Initiative, Northern New Jersey PIC Ed Efchick, WX2R, and Alan Griffin, who represents Radio Amateurs of Canada on the committee.
ARRL's new chief executive officer, Barry Shelley, N1VXY, moved one floor down at ARRL headquarters earlier this year to assume leadership of the organization with an overarching goal of promoting the league's mission to advance the art, science, and enjoyment of amateur radio. Shelley has spent much of his tenure at the ARRL headquarters toiling out of the limelight, so he's a bit of an unknown quantity within the greater amateur radio community. But he brings to his new position nearly three decades of experience as ARRL's chief financial officer. Shelley intends to leverage that background in his role as CEO, enabling him to hit the ground running. I am familiar with issues that matter to the ARRL members and the amateur radio community at large, Shelley pointed out in his inaugural Second Century editorial, Advancing Amateur Radio Together, in the April issue of QST. He acknowledged that with both ARRL and amateur radio undergoing a great deal of change, not all league members will necessarily be on the same page. But he believes disagreement about the way forward can be healthy and bring new perspectives to light. At the same time, he encouraged individuals to remain respectful and constructive in discussing issues about which they may not agree. In my opinion, fulfilling the ARRL's mission means doing so for all amateur radio operators, regardless of their license class, level of technical ability, or particular interests within the wide range of activities that amateur radio has to offer, Shelley allowed. Increasing the number of younger radio amateurs will benefit both the avocation and ARRL, he said. And despite any generational rift, perceived or otherwise, between older and younger hams, there's more to enjoy than ever before. Amateur radio in 2018 looks and sounds different than it did in 1968 or even 1988, and licensing numbers indicate that people are still interested in exploring amateur radio. Blazing the trail for amateur radio's future should involve all hams, Shelley believes, noting that for more than a year, a team at ARRL headquarters has been looking into how to better define the needs of radio amateurs in the various generational and interest groups and plan for how the ARRL can respond to those needs effectively. ARRL's research, he said, has made clear that all radio amateurs want help, regardless of license class, experience, and interests. They want help figuring out which activities to get involved in, what kind of gear they need for those activities, and where to find like-minded fellow hams, Shelley wrote, urging radio amateurs to be there for each other. We all need to keep our vibrant and varied community moving forward amid great change, Shelley concluded. Let's keep encouraging others to join our wonderful hobby. Let's keep talking to each other, and let's keep teaching each other. After all, that's the tried and true ham way. It's how we've gotten this far. The ARRL board elected Shelley as CEO in January to succeed Tom Gallagher, NY2RF, who has retired. As Shelley himself nears his own retirement over the next 18 months, the league continues to advertise for applicants to fill the CEO position on a long-term basis.
ARRL is seeking a full-time chief executive officer in Newington, Connecticut, to direct its day-to-day activities. ARRL has 159,000 members, an annual budget of $15 million, 90 paid employees, a nationwide network of volunteers, and an elected board of 15 directors. ARRL publishes a monthly membership journal, QST, as well as many publications on radio-related topics, sponsors educational and membership programs across a wide array of amateur radio activity, and represents amateur radio to the general public, as well as with the United States government and internationally. Reporting to the board of directors and the president, the chief executive officer is responsible for leadership and management of staff, planning and tracking financial results and corporate compliance, maintaining effective member interface and service levels, monitoring regulatory developments, and directing advocacy and public relations in an effort to support amateur radio domestically and worldwide. He or she will work with the board of directors, officers, and other management towards achievement of the league's goals, strategies, and plans for the betterment of amateur radio. The CEO works collaboratively with the board of directors in leading ARRL in accordance with its articles of association, bylaws, and board policies. Specifically, he or she will ensure the day-to-day management of ARRL and its fiscal operation. In addition, he or she will oversee and make certain that ARRL's fundraising, marketing, human resources, technology, advocacy, and governance strategies are effectively implemented across all segments of the organization. Additional information is on the ARRL website. The closing date for the application is May 31st, 2018.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the propagation forecast for Friday, April 6th. The sun is quiet and utterly blank, not a single spot to be found. As a result, the solar flux index has sunk to a pitiful 68, which means that conditions on the HF bands are about as mediocre as you'd expect. Look for some decent openings on 20 meters, but if you venture to the higher bands, well, good luck. You may be better off exploring 40 meters at night. 80 meters may be promising as well, but as we move into spring, thunderstorm activity will start ramping up, and static crashes may make 80 meters difficult at times. On VHF and UHF, springtime brings the start of sporadic E activity on 6 meters. Monitor 6 meters from late morning to late afternoon, starting now, for best results. On 2 meters and up, hams in California, Arizona, and New Mexico may be in for some tropospheric ducting fireworks over the weekend. Openings may pop up in Washington State as well.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. How do you work amateur radio on a train? Well, one member of our staff recently took an extended trip and put together a four-part series on doing just that. So, without further ado, here is our very own Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, who is on the rails.
I'm Greg Stoddard, KF9MP on the rails, reporting for This Week in Amateur Radio. These days, more and more people are deciding to take the train instead of flying the crowded skies, with their cramped, uncomfortable seats, crazy drunk people, or being treated like a criminal at the airport. This becomes especially true when people realize that the trip itself can also become a part of the destination. At the airport and on the airplane, using electronics like a GPS, VHF scanners, and sometimes even your laptop computer can be forbidden or even seized. So what about using ham radio or other wireless electronics on board a long-distance passenger train? You can probably visualize that modern passenger rail cars are highly electronic and operate many high-amperage AC circuits inside. On the outside, trains often share the rail right-of-way with very high-voltage, noisy power lines running alongside the tracks mile after mile. The RF environment inside the Amtrak cars tends to be as noisy as inside any modern-day American home. These grounded stainless steel train cars attenuate outside signals and serve as directional barriers to RF and can also tend to keep radio noise safely inside the car. But I was still able to listen to AM and FM broadcasts with my tiny HT, and I could work 2 meter simplex and some repeaters just fine from inside the sleeper car. The modern Amtrak cars are often 2 stories tall, which gives you a definite height advantage over working from your car. Using my tiny HT as a scanner worked better than I expected. Rail companies in the USA have their own band from 159 to 162 megahertz, divided into about 100 channels every 15 kilohertz. They use analog narrow FM for voice and also some telemetry beacons. They also use a special gear on higher bands like 220.1 and 452 megahertz, and in the realm of cellular from 826 to 928 megahertz, but most of these are for data and telemetry. On a recent Amtrak trip, I found most of the crew using FM handhelds. Most of the larger rail stations used FM simplex, following the same channel schemes I found online. You can program all 100 rail channels into your HT and follow most of their voice traffic. Listening to the dispatchers at the larger stations provided a good source of information about work being done on the train cars, causes of delays, or possible traffic conflicts up ahead. Rail employees have their jargon just like in aviation, and it was interesting to hear them use the readback method to make sure that instructions from the dispatchers were correctly received. Amtrak does not own the tracks they run on, but shares them with a host freight company that actually own and maintain the rails, which means passenger service sometimes has to park and wait for the freight traffic to clear. This also means Amtrak is operating a passenger service on a rail network designed for freight trains who probably don't care about how smooth or quiet the ride is. It also means that delays are generally well communicated by radio from the conductor to the dispatchers on one of those 100 VHF channels, so you'll be well informed about the delays and that most commonly asked question, how long till we get there? On my 2.5 day rail adventure, I was the only passenger that knew the actual cause of some of our delays, which are common for Amtrak service, so they're very upfront about them. If you search online for Amtrak radio channels, you'll find lots of resources, lists of channels, and what frequencies the dispatchers use. It's well worth the time and easy to program into your handheld using programming software on your computer, like my little Yaesu HT that ran the entire 2,200 mile trip on just 3 AA batteries. There is one caveat I'd like to offer people intending to ride our U.S. passenger rail carriers about an interesting thing I discovered this winter while riding on the Texas Eagle line from Los Angeles to San Antonio and then north to Chicago. Our train stopped in El Paso, Texas for about an hour. I grabbed my cell phone to text my location to relatives and got a text message bounced back advising me I was accessing a Mexican cellular company. It said I should text back a particular code to avoid being billed at an astoundingly high rate. I didn't fall for that trick and my text was never sent, but the lesson learned is whenever you're near the U.S. border, be careful when using your cell phone or even your HT. You may have been switched to a foreign cell company with huge data and text rates without any warning. And in some areas along our border, transmitting on 2 meters or UHF may also not even be allowed. The El Paso train station is just a couple hundred feet from our border with Mexico. My best advice is to put your cell phone in airplane mode when you're near the Amtrak station in downtown El Paso, Texas. In our next episode, we'll cover using your HT on the train. I'm Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, from Phoenix, Arizona, on the rails, reporting for This Week in Amateur Radio.
ARRL and CQ Magazine have announced the launch, effective immediately, of Logbook of the World support for CQ's Work Doll Zones Award Program. The goal of the project, underway since last year, has been to create the proper technical support system to enable radio amateurs to submit Log of the World confirmations for Work Doll Zones credit, and that has been accomplished, CQ and ARRL said in a joint statement. Log of the World already supports CQ's WPX Award Program. We are very pleased that participants in CQ's Work Doll Zones Award Program will now be able to use their Log of the World confirmations for award credit, CQ editor Rich Mosesen, W2VU, said. CQ WPX Award participants have found it very helpful, and we are sure it will be equally helpful for those pursuing Work Doll Zones and its many variations. ARRL First Vice President Greg Whitten, KOGW, concurred. Users of Log of the World have been telling us for some time that they would like to use QSLs from Log of the World to apply for the Work Doll Zones Award, he said. They will now be able to select confirmations to be used for Work Doll Zones credit. Beta testing has been underway since mid-December 2017 to bring the Work Doll Zones Award Program into Log of the World, and the Log of the World technical support team has addressed any problems in the implementation that testers uncovered. Documentation was also improved through feedback from beta testers. At the same time, each Log of the World user was given an additional Work Doll Zones account. Standard Log of the World credit fees and separate CQ award fees will apply. Log of the World, ARRL's electronic confirmation system for amateur radio contacts, provides contact confirmation when both stations upload their logs to the system and a match between the logs is confirmed. Log of the World has supported the CQ WPX Award Program since 2012.
The second public test of the FT8D Expedition Mode will take place on April 7th, and all radio amateurs are invited to participate. WSJTX developer Joe Taylor, K1JT, advises anyone planning to take part to download the latest release candidate beta version of WSJTX, now called 1.9.0 RC3, and to read the latest revision of the FT8D Expedition Mode User Guide dated March 28th, which includes changes and updates from previous User Guide editions. Taylor specifically would like users to pay attention to the section on page 1, which reads, quote, "Please note, de-expedition mode is not yet ready for production use. Until WSJTX version 1.9.0 is fully released, FT8 de-expedition mode should be used only in control test situations. Please remember to send us your test results," close quote. Taylor said the WSJTX development team is suggesting these temporary frequencies for testing de-expedition mode, 3.567, 7.066, 10.1405, 14.105, 18.095, 21.067, 24.911, and 28.067 megahertz. Taylor said he stressed that FT8 de-expedition mode is not ready for routine use. Recently, one short de-expedition did deploy FT8 de-expedition mode, but users in the pileup were not necessarily fully on board with how to use the new mode, or were using versions of FT8 that were incompatible with the de-expedition mode iteration. Taylor said that posting FT8 de-expedition mode operating frequencies for each HF band was done in the hope that it might minimize interference with other digital modes.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air.
Are you ready for another trip into amateur radio history? I'm Bill Continelli, W2XOY, and I'll be back in a moment with another edition of the Ancient Amateur Archives. Here on This Week in Amateur Radio.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and I'm talking with Bart Yonke, W9JJ, the ARRL Contest Branch Manager. And this being early April, Bart, it's time for a grid chase update. What's going on?
It sure is, Steve. Today is April 5th, so we're coming up on the next deadline for upload submissions. The March upload submission deadline is April 10th. At 2359 UTC. So we want to make sure first and foremost that people get their QSO entered into their logs, get their logs uploaded. Let's get some credit going.
Do you have an idea how many entries or logs we've received?
Right now, I was just looking at the online leaderboard review, and it's talking about 23,100 entries, and that's already surpassed what we were seeing for the months of January and February.
23,000. Do you expect this to increase as we get into better weather?
I think this trend is going to continue where it is because we're coming off of the winter doldrums where people maybe are staying home more often. You're going to see some peaks of varying bands as we go on. You know, you're going to see 80 and 40 and 160 drop a little bit, perhaps. But you're going to see 15 and 10 pick up, 6 meters pick up. We're going to be coming into the VHF contesting and activity season. So these are all activity generators.
Yeah, we're going to be coming up to a 6-meter sporadic e-season pretty soon.
We definitely are. You know, you get into the month of April and beyond, and these afternoon and evening openings are going to become more common. And add to that the fact that people are operating continually in some of the more digital modes anyway, and it's just going to build on itself. We also have the sprints coming up, which are sponsored by third-party organizations each year. And the first one's coming up on 2 meters this next Monday.
And that reminds me, are there any modes in particular that seem to be popular? Is FT8 still the hot mode for the grid chase?
FT8 is definitely still the hot mode, and by a 2-to-1 over the CW and phone bands. And that will continue. I think the popularity is driving that, as well as the ease of use. Don't forget that planning for field day is starting now amongst groups. And while FT8 isn't necessarily a mode that will be easily used because of the complicated exchanges that field day requires, that doesn't mean that you can't start planning for your field day location from, say, a less active grid square. Again, it's not about the exchange. It's about the QSOs when you upload them to logbook, and your TQSL station location will have that grid square in it when you do the uploads.
Excellent. Thank you, Bart.
Thanks, Steve.
This is Bill Continelli, W2XOY, with Amateur Radio History Headlines.
1970. The amateur population is 250,000, but stagnant. The license fees and incentive licensing are blamed. Meanwhile, 2-meter FM is starting to boom. New equipment designed for the amateur market joins the surplus wideband commercial radios which were converted for use on 146.94. Megahertz and kilohertz replace megacycles and kilocycles. And amateur radio is dragged into the Vietnam War protest movement with the Student Information Net operating on college campuses nationwide. 1971. The Japanese are starting to dominate the amateur markets. National, Hammerland, Hallicrafters, and Gonset were beginning to fade away, but Drake, Tentec, Heathkit, and Collins were still going strong. 1972. A national 2-meter FM band plan was announced. 146.52 was chosen as the national simplex frequency. The FCC released the first repeater rules, expanded the technician 2-meter allocation to 145 through 148 megahertz, and relaxed mobile logging requirements.
This has been Amateur Radio History Headlines with Bill Continelli, W2XOY, for this week in Amateur Radio.
IARU Region 1 President Don Beatty, G3BJ, is expressing concern that wireless power transfer for electric vehicles, also referred to as WPT-EV equipment, could pose a threat to amateur radio spectrum. WPT-EV, which typically uses frequencies in the LF and MF range, allows the charging of electric vehicle batteries without having to plug into a power source. WPT-EV is high-duty cycle, located in residential areas, and its harmonics are likely to be spread across a band of frequencies, Beatty explained in a briefing entitled Wireless Power Transmission for Electric Vehicles. Beatty fears the WPT-EV could end up being installed at residences of electric vehicle owners, generating noise that could obscure radio communications in and around the home environment. Many non-radio devices are coming on stream, which emit high levels of wideband radio noise, which can mask essential communications, the latest technology being WPT, Beatty said in a post on his website. The threats to radio communications is a rather thick fog, which prevents us from seeing things by distance. So it is that the radio spectrum is being polluted in a way which, unchecked, will radically reduce its usefulness. Beatty said that in his role as IARU Region 1 president, he's been heavily involved in discussions on this technology. He pointed to the IARU Region 1 white paper, Unwanted Emissions in the Spurious Domain from Wireless Power Transfer for Electric Vehicles on Frequencies Allocated to the Amateur Service, which seeks to support of other countries to ensure that spurious emissions limits are set for WPT, which will protect incumbent radio services in the urban, suburban, residential environment. World Radio Communication Conference 19 Agenda 9.1.6 calls for the urgent studies of WPT to assess its impact on radio communication services and to study suitable harmonized frequency ranges that could minimize the impact on the radio spectrum. In a 2016 report, Applications of Wireless Power Transmission via Radio Frequency Beam, the International Telecommunications Union called WPT a game-changing technology. Will be able to become free from lacking electric power when it will be supplied wirelessly, the report said. Wireless power technology would still operate using inductive coupling from a charging pad on the floor beneath the vehicle. Whilst the technology is still under development, some installations for public service vehicles like buses are already in operation using the charging frequencies around 20 kilohertz, Beatty said. Discussions are underway in countries that are members of the European Conference of Postal and Telecommunications Administration, the International Special Committee on Radio Interference, and ITU, over the introduction of wireless power transmission for electric vehicles on a widespread basis across Europe. Domestic charging systems are expected to use a frequency around 85 kilohertz, and Beatty said this poses a real risk to radio communication resulting from the harmonics that the high-power charging installations would generate. It's not yet clear what actual spurious performance of WPT will be, but it is clear that to provide inadequate protection to radio services in the residential environment, the existing limits will need to be tightened significantly, the IARU Region 1 white paper asserted.
An upcoming Wake Island operation will make a rare grade available. Starting in April, Philip Garrison, N7NVK, will begin working on Wake Island, which is in grid RK39 for those participating in the 2018 ARRL International Grid Chase. His schedule calls for 3 months on the island and then 1 month off, a pattern that will repeat over the course of about a year. Keep in mind that Wake is 12 hours ahead of UTC. Garrison does not yet know what days or times he will be on the air, but he plans to post his availability on his QRZ.com profile page and notify ARRL to include it in its DX bulletin. He's taking along an Elecraft KX3, along with a G5RV or buddy pole for an antenna and running low power. He will operate split, and he asks for patience because he's not used to being the focus of a pileup. Internet connectivity on Wake will be limited, but he plans to use Logbook of the World.
We are This Week in Amateur Radio, your amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air, available online at www.twiar.net.
And now with the latest technology news and commentary from Petaluma, California, This Week in Amateur Radio is proud to present Leo Laporte.
Oh, now it's time for me to talk. I was under my desk. Excuse me. When you're a tech guy, hello everybody, Leo Laporte here, the tech guy. When you're a tech guy, you often go under your desk, right? Am I ringing a bell? You know, you reach under there because there's wiring and stuff, and I had a new wireless charger I needed to plug in, and that meant a trip down below. And it's funny because whenever I go underneath this desk, my engineers come running in. It's not that they think I had a heart attack or something and have fallen, but because they don't like seeing me go down there because they know danger, Will Robinson. I might do something and break things. I didn't. Everything's fine. Charger's working. If you're the type of person that spends a little bit of time clambering beneath your desk, this is the show for you. Get any good Easter eggs today? April Fool's Day and Easter for the first time in 60 2 years on the same day. So long before the internet, right? 1956 was the last time Easter and April Fools were on the same day. So this is a red letter day, a once in a blue moon opportunity for the computer industry to really mess around with you. I think am I wrong? It used to be, it seemed only a few years ago that there were April Fool's jokes everywhere. I think maybe it got tiresome because you'd read the news and you wouldn't know what to believe. And Google seemed to spend more energy on April Fool's jokes than their actual services. And I think there must have been at some point a few years ago a memo that went out that said, all right, knock it off. It's just another day. Google's April Fool's jokes have been fairly benign since. And also, I think few. There are a few, but not anywhere near, feels like, not anywhere near the number there have been in years past. And here's the good news. You can go and read the news, and you don't have to look at each article and go, is this true? It is April Fool's. Is this true? We talked about Where's Waldo and Google Maps. That's one. That's fun. If you haven't done that yet, go open your Google Maps app on your phone and you'll see a little Waldo and you can play the game for some time. The Google Cloud folks announced Google Cloud Hummus. Yeah, you could tell they're not putting the same amount of energy in this year. That was it. That's pretty much it. T-Mobile announced a smart shoe phone in a Converse style pink, or I guess that's magenta, isn't it? Sneaker called T-Mobile's Sidekicks. See, it's a mistake to announce that because I think some people would want it. Gaming company Razer announced something they're called Project Venom 2, a nanobot-based upgrade that turns you into gaming hardware. See, I don't mind that because there's just, you know, you look at that and go, yeah, right. Ironically, there was one announcement this April Fool's that sounded like an April Fool's joke and wasn't. In fact, I haven't tried it yet, but I'm going to mention it because it might be worth trying. A company called Cloudflare, I like a lot. Cloudflare is a company that kind of provides internet services for large companies, announced a new DNS service, 1111. I was sure this is an April Fool's joke, but Matthew Prince, their CEO, said, yeah, you may wonder why we're launching this on April Fool's Day. Well, we just thought 4-1s on 4-1 made a lot of sense. 1.1.1.1 would replace your internet service provider's DNS. That's something that's set automatically in your computer or your router, if you have a router. When you're looking up an address on the internet, you go to the domain name server or DNS server and say, hey, I want to go to yahoo.com. What number is that? And it's like a phone book, really. Typically, you'll use your internet service providers. That's kind of the default. But 1.1.1.1 is a replacement that you could actually put in. Almost all routers, all computers have a place where you could substitute the default DNS phone book with your own. And the idea is 1.1.1.1 is privacy forward. It would keep your internet service provider from capturing the information it gets from you using their phone book. That's nice. It's possible Cloudflare could add at some point protection from malware or even advertising. DNS really is a powerful tool. If an advertising server can't look up its address, it can't serve you ads. I don't think they're doing that yet, but I wouldn't be surprised to see something like that. So 1.1.1.1 is, I'm pretty sure, as much as it looks like an April Fool's joke, I'm pretty sure it's not. And it uses something that is very good and modern called DNS over HTTPS. It encrypts the data about your web browsing as it goes online. Another nice privacy feature. So they're really focused on privacy when you use 1.1.1.1. And potentially, if it's a good server and it's working well, it could speed you up as well. DNS servers from your internet service provider sometimes are not the best. Sometimes they're a little slow. Although the good news is 1.1.1.1 comes from Cloudflare, one of whose business is remediating what they call denial of service attacks. They have a lot of bandwidth and servers all over the world. So if anybody could handle an onslaught of traffic, it would be Cloudflare. I guess we got to talk about right now about cell phones because I told you, I said it many times, if there's any danger from radiation from cell phones or Wi-Fi, I'll let you know. And as I said many times, so far there isn't, but now there is. But it is not cause for concern yet. We're waiting for recommendations from the FDA and others. But there is some evidence that there may be, well, it can cause cancer in male rats. Not so sure about female rats. And as always with these kinds of studies, you know, there were exposed to a lot of radiation over a number of years, 2 years. But here's the thing that's interesting. The original study, this takes a little understanding about how this works. This is a federal study from the U.S. National Toxicology Program, NTP. And the NTP uses labels to indicate how strong the evidence is. There's the strongest, which is clear evidence, some evidence, equivocal evidence, and no evidence. When the original researchers produced their study, they labeled the evidence equivocal, which is the second lowest. Researchers couldn't be sure what radiation caused the tumors, or that the radiation indeed caused tumors. One problem is the longer you go with these rat studies, the more likely they're just going to get tumors, because that's what rats do as they age. But then, interestingly, the studies, the pair of studies, went through what they call peer review, where you get a bunch of experts, people who are, in the field, and the peer review committee upgraded, which is very rare, upgraded the studies, the folks who did the studies, recommendation. And they upgraded it from equivocal evidence, in some cases, to clear evidence. Now, that's why it caught my attention, because clear evidence means they believe there is a provable link. So that is really interesting. This is the first study that's ever shown this. There have been a number of studies that have kind of hinted at, or maybe... So I guess the reason I bring this up is, you know, these have been passed now along to the Food and Drug Administration. The guy who designed the studies, a senior toxicologist with the National Toxicology Program, has retired. He retired almost 10 years ago. He retired a while ago. But he said, this is a double negative. It's unlikely that any future study could conclude with certainty that there is no risk to humans. He said, at this point, it's going to be hard to say there is zero risk. Still harder. It's hard still to prove that there is how much risk there is. But it's no longer can we say there is no risk, or we can show there's no risk. He said, I don't think that's the case. He said he believes the FDA should put out indications to the public that you should, and these are his words, Ronald Melnick, maintain a distance from the cell phone device to your children. Don't sleep with the cell phone next to your head, and use wired headsets. And he thinks the FDA should do that right now. So I'm passing this along to you. I have to quibble with that last one, use wired headsets. And in fact, it kind of casts a little doubt now into this guy, because a wired headset, if there's danger from the cell phone, putting a wired headset in your ear would not protect you from the cell phone. It would just conduct that radiation right into your ear. So that, I don't know. I mean, maybe he knows more, something I don't know. But so this is interesting. The upgrade, particularly what's interesting, is this never happens in peer review. That they will downgrade or approve the study, but they will rarely upgrade the study. In other words, the researchers said the evidence was equivocal. We're not sure. And the peer review said, no, this is a good study. It's equivocal. We feel the data, when combined with our knowledge of the cancers and the design of the study, which we think is very good, we think this proves, or at least shows, a clear connection. So I just wanted to pass this along to you. What do you do now? I don't know. I'm still going to carry two cell phones in my pocket, one right next to my heart. Although some of the rats did get heart tumors, I should point out. The papers found there was clear evidence that exposure to cell phone radiation increases risk for a rare type of malignant tumor called a schwannoma in the connective tissues that surround the nerves around the heart. So in the past, we've always said this isn't possible. This is not likely because, It's what we call non-ionizing radiation. It's not like an X-ray. You know, you wouldn't have an X-ray machine carry around in your pocket. That'd be a bad idea. Or take too many X-rays, you know. But that's ionizing radiation. This radiation is considered too weak to do damage to cells. It's non-ionizing radiation. And that's why I've said, and many have said, and I've stuck by it until now, there's no danger from cell phones. But this might be something we want to pay attention to. This is a good study, and it did find some evidence. All right. So I just want to let you know, because I told you, I was very clear. If this should happen, if we should see this, I'll let you know. Now my duty is done. Whew, okay. That's a little scary, isn't it? Don't sleep with one under your pillow. That probably seemed like good advice. Remember, as I've said many times, the distance between you and the cell phone is important. That this kind of radiation, all radiation, decreases by the square of the distance, which means it goes down really, really fast. So 1 foot might be sufficient. 2 feet might be sufficient. Keep it, you know, in your briefcase or your purse. That's probably fine. Don't worry so much about it. But let's pay attention to this, and we'll keep paying attention, and I'll give you the information. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
You're listening to North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, distributed worldwide at TWIAR.net.
I'm Larry McClure, KB9DIP. Morse code was the bane of many a wannabe ham for years until code was eliminated by the FCC from the entry-level testing program of amateur radio. For the uninitiated, the use of Morse code goes back well over a century. An Indiana man who became a ham way back in 1927 was Lewis Coe, W9CNY. At the turn of the century, in 2000, Rains Hap Holly, KC9RP, spoke with Lewis about the evolution of this nonverbal language.
How did the whole idea of Morse code come about in the first place?
Well, mainly because they had developed the idea that they could control a magnet at a distance, but they needed some way to transform this into usable communication, and so that was what they did. They finally figured that a dot and a dash could be combined in various ways to represent the alphabet, and that was how they were going to communicate. The idea wasn't exactly original with Morse, because some people in Europe had developed codes too, but Morse is the only one whose idea was ever adopted and used to any extent, but that was the basis for it. They needed some way to transform these magnetic pulses into useful information, so they came up with this code, and they analyzed the English language and discovered that more E's were used than anything else, so they assigned that one dot, the shortest symbol. And there's always been a lot of controversy as to whether it was Morse or Alfred Vail that invented the code, but I think the best guess is that it was a joint effort of the two men. But Vail's ancestors always insisted that he was the one that developed it. So that's how it got started.
What was the background of Samuel Morse?
Samuel Morse was actually a professional artist, a portrait painter. He started out as a painter, and he made several well-known paintings, and he was on a trip to Europe in that connection, and he, on the way home, of course, those days it took about 6 weeks to cross the Atlantic, so they had a lot of time to think about things. And the electricity, of course, this was, in those days, there had been no practical application of electricity whatsoever, but Morse was an educated man, and he'd heard about electricity. And so while he was on this voyage from England to America in 1832, he got the idea that this idea could be used to communicate with, which nobody else really had thought about too much. And by the time he reached New York, he had the basic idea in mind, but he didn't have time to work on it right away because he was almost penniless in those days. And he finally got a job with New York University as an art teacher, I think it was, and he used his spare time to develop this experimental telegraph system. And then, of course, he never got anywhere with that until he finally got a grant from Congress to build this line from Washington to Baltimore, about 1843, 44, along in there. He was really just almost destitute when he was at the university. He rented some rooms from the university, and he developed this machine, which was made out of an old canvas stretcher. There's replicas of it in existence. This thing traced the lines, the dots and dashes on a moving paper tape, and for many years, quite a few years at least, while that was, they finally developed some more sophisticated recorders, but they started out with a system of recording the dots and dashes on a paper tape. Eventually, the guys that operated these machines got used to the clicks of the machine and discovered they could read the messages by ear. So about 1850, well, that became the method that was used then for the rest of the life of the Morse telegraph, reading by ear. That was the way it started out. The line to Baltimore in 1844 was the first practical demonstration, and they were going to put that line underground, but unfortunately the underground cable at that time wasn't any good, and they couldn't make it work, so they finally strung the line on poles, and that set the pattern for the rest of the time. And if the underground experiment had succeeded, it might have changed the whole character of communications. We would have had underground lines in the beginning as we have now, but they just didn't have the adequate facilities for making the cable that would provide underground service.
They didn't have preamps in those days to reamplify a signal over many, many miles. How far did the actual magnetic pulse travel down that wire between Washington and, was it Baltimore, you said?
Yeah. Well, I forget what the actual mileage is. I don't suppose it would be more than 100 miles, if that. But it turned out that in actual practice, you could work Morse telegraphy up to about 300 miles. Then as the technology improved, while they developed means of repeaters, which would insert new battery at intervals. So with that, you could go any length you wanted to, and that eventually led to the transcontinental telegraph line, that New York could work San Francisco direct because it had repeaters at intervals, which put on new battery and transmitted the signal.
What were these repeaters like?
They were electromagnetic devices, and the first ones were one-way repeaters. That is, they could only transmit in one direction at a time, but then in the 1860s, well, they developed the repeater that was a two-way repeater. And these were fairly complex. They had three or four relays in them, and they were rather intricate in operation, but they could send from east to west. But if west wanted to break east, he could, you know, he could interrupt the sender and so on. The incoming signal, let's say from the east, came into the coil of a relay and operated that relay, and that in turn operated some local circuits and eventually actuated a sending relay that was on the western side of the repeater. So it's a little bit complicated to describe, and it's actually a rather complicated circuit, but it does require an incoming relay and an outgoing relay and then several intermediate instruments. It requires at least two or three sources of power. It doesn't work all on the same batteries, but they had at least two or three sources of battery. And, of course, these things are clicking all the time in response to whatever signal is coming in from one side and going out the other. But even to this day, they're a fairly complicated thing, and for that reason, they were only installed at main points where they had people that were trained to adjust them and get them working right. That made it possible to extend a telegraph circuit any distance, really.
Lou, you mentioned the first telegraphic run of wire ran from Washington, D.C. to Baltimore, Maryland. You figure about 100 miles. Was there some effect of capacitance in that magnetic line that degraded or altered the signal between those two points?
Yes, there was. The telegraph wire had capacitance as well as inductance, but this effect wasn't too well understood at first, and some of the first experiments with duplex and printing telegraphs and so on didn't realize the effects of capacity. They thought that by just putting in lumped inductance equal to the line value that they could simulate the operation, but the experiments didn't take capacity into account, and of course it was an important factor. So there was a capacity, and wire chiefs eventually learned to check for an open wire. They would check it by applying a voltage and seeing how far a voltmeter kicked upscale, roughly measuring the capacity, and it was a important effect, all right. And but for simple Morse operation, of course, you didn't have to worry about that. The basic Morse circuits would work up to about 300 miles without any repeaters, and didn't worry about the capacity effect because it didn't enter in, but it was there, all right.
One thing I don't understand, how can Morse code have gone 300 miles without any kind of repeaters, if you will, in line, whereas today there's no way that you could convey audio anywhere near that distance without reamplification?
Well, of course, today most of your circuits are in cable, and cable has an even higher capacity for foot than an open wire line, and Morse code basically relied on the simple principles of Ohm's law. What goes in has to come out, less the resistance of the line. And today, why most of your circuits are either in cable or else they're derived from some radio link of some kind, they can compensate for all these various effects. But the simple Morse circuit didn't have to worry about any of those things. All it had to do was have enough voltage to come out at the other end, and they usually used a relay in the line to respond to the line current, and the relay in turn operated a local sounder, so the relay was more sensitive and enables you to work on a very poor line or with very low current. The circuits I worked on with postal telegraph had about 150 volts on the line, and that would get through almost anything. And of course, a lot of the early lines were very poor, a lot of grounds and so on. But as long as something came out the far end, and of course, Ohm's law pretty well established that. In the beginning, why a lot of electrical engineers thought that electricity wouldn't penetrate a wire for an infinite distance, that it would just peter out, but it never disappears, just always there, except that it gets weaker according to the distance. But the first transatlantic cables were a good example. A lot of people didn't think they would work, but when they went to test the transatlantic cables, why, they had two of them across the Atlantic, and the guy hooked up a test outfit. He had one end joined together, so he had a loop across the Atlantic and back again to Ireland where he was, and he had just a tiny battery, which he improvised on the spot, but it couldn't have been more than a wristwatch battery nowadays, but it was enough to prove the theory that the current was getting through there. And they used very mirror galvanometers to measure the current, of course, and it was very weak, but it was there.
It just boggles my mind, not being an engineer and only dabbling in audio as we know it today, that such a weak signal or a low power signal, literally powered by what amounts to, I guess, a watch battery, in those days, actually would go that far down a cable, 2,500 miles each way, and not have the signal entirely attenuated by the time it reached the other end.
That does seem miraculous, but after you study Ohm's law, why, you realize it can happen, but the current is very weak and takes a very sensitive device to detect it, of course, but it does work. And at that time, a lot of the learned opinion of the day held that it wouldn't work. You know, they didn't think that, they thought electricity would just gradually attenuate it in a long wire and just gradually die out to nothing, but of course it never does. But you got to have the right equipment to detect it, and that was one of the reasons that the Morse telegraph was so successful, because almost any kind of a line, or some of the early lines were very poorly built, poorly insulated, some weren't insulated at all, and they could put the battery on there and communicate between two points.
And that concludes the first of two excerpts from a year 2000 conversation Rains Hap Holly, KC9RP, had with Crown Point, Indiana ham, Lewis Coe, W9CNY. We'll learn more about the evolution of Morse code next time. I'm Larry McGlure, KB9DIP, bidding you a very 73 from the Radio Amateur Information Network.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. Have you ever considered the infrastructure that exists to make it possible to tune to 7.090 MHz, call CQ, and make contact with anyone on the planet? In a world where we as radio amateurs share spectrum with radio and television broadcasters, mobile phones, wireless networks, satellites, GPS, drones, wireless headphones, radar, boating, aviation, citizen band, garage door openers, fitness trackers, and any other wireless gadget imaginable, not to mention radio astronomy, microwave ovens, meteorological aids, inter and intra car communication, autonomous cars, trains, and more. The world clamors for spectrum, and in and among those allocations we find the amateur bands. There are 24 million odd people in Australia, a few normal people, but mostly odd, and about 14,000 radio amateur license holders. That's about 0.06% of the population. It's extraordinary that in the last 100 years of radio spectrum allocation, we have access to the bands we have. It's easy to forget that in the rarefied air of amateur radio, where we have access to an astonishing amount of spectrum, how unique we really are. Not only do we have a situation where we have access to bands, this is mostly global access. There are exceptions, and while bands don't exactly line up, for example 7.090 MHz in Australia and the UK is an SSB calling frequency, but in the United States this is a CW Ritian data frequency, still amateur radio, but not the same mode. How this allocation exists is a combination of being the first mover, that is, radio amateurs came along and used it before anyone else had any use for this spectrum, and the existence of the International Amateur Radio Union, the IARU. The IARU is a topic in and of itself, but in essence it's an organization that exists and has done since 1925, due to radio amateurs combining their efforts. The IARU consists of over 160 member countries, which are represented by their peak body. In Australia, the WIA, the UK has the RSGB, and the US has the ARRL. So if you're a member of one of those organizations, you, in turn, are represented at the IARU, where volunteers represent you and me on the world stage. The IARU has organized the world into three regions that correspond with the International Telecommunications Union. Region 1 is Europe, Africa, the Middle East, and Russia. Region 2 is the Americas. Region 3 is the rest, Asia and the Pacific. That includes India and China. At some level, discussion about the IARU, the role it plays and the processes it has and the services it offers, is a dry and boring administrative slog. It's not sexy. It's not thrilling. But every once in a while, I think it would be a great idea to consider what the world might look like without the IARU and what our hobby might look like had this organization not existed. There are some public activities that the IARU engages in. The Beacon Project, the HF World Championships, and the Worked All Continents Award. There is the monitoring system and other activities such as the Amateur Radio Direction Finding or ARDF Championships. The public relations face aside, much of the activity of the IARU is invisible. Going to meetings, making proposals, keeping abreast of new technology and threats to radio spectrum, participating in working and study groups, and the administration of all this volunteer effort. Next time you call CQ and a station on the other side of the planet answers, consider some of the invisible forces at work that make it possible. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima, Alpha Bravo.
In late March, Paul Kelly, N1BUG of Milo, Maine, completed what may have been the first transatlantic 2200-meter contact by a U.S. radio amateur under amateur radio rules. Signals in this part of the spectrum and lower previously have spanned the Atlantic in one direction, and Canadian radio amateurs have reported transatlantic contacts on the band dating back several years. To the best of my knowledge, this is the first transatlantic two-way QSO from the U.S. on 2,200 meters under Part 97 operation, said Kelly, who told ARRL that he gravitates toward the more challenging, weak signal aspects of amateur radio and has been experimenting and DXing for 37 years now. 2,200 meters is my new passion, and I'm having a lot of fun with it, he said. I had been dreaming of and working toward a transatlantic QSO on 2,200 meters for some time. Recently, I asked Chris Wilson, 2EOILY, if he would be interested in trying to work with me on DFC W60 mode. Chris and I have heard each other on WSPR, but he does not hear me well enough yet for a JT9 or other digital QSO. Chris agreed to try DFC W60, dual frequency CW, 60-second dit length. This was not a quick contact. It took 4 nights to complete using night-by-night sequencing. Kelly called that the minimum possible time for such a contact, which included an exchange of complete call signs, signal reports, and acknowledgments. Kelly said they used the TMOR reporting system borrowed from the moon-bounce world. The QSO was completed at 0020 UTC March 28th when I received R from Chris, Kelly said. He noted that the weather did not cooperate on his first night of transmitting, with snow squalls affecting antenna tuning. Fortunately, I have a remotely controlled variometer at the antenna, he told ARRL. Otherwise, I could have not kept the transmitter going or alive that night. For over 2 hours, I had to tweak it almost every key down, roughly every 90 seconds. Things calmed down to the point where we only had to adjust it every 10 to 15 minutes. Kelly's 2,200-meter station consists of a QRP Labs Ultimate 3S transmitter, a home-built single FET 200-watt classy amplifier, and a 90-foot top-loaded vertical antenna. This gives me no more than 0.5-watt EIRP, probably less, he said. For receiving, he uses a 30-foot low-noise vertical homebrew bandpass filter, preamp, and a modified Softrock Lite 2 software-defined radio receiver kit, with the local oscillator modified for coverage on 2200, with front-end filter modifications and additional filter sections added.
The FCC has announced a new honors engineering program to recruit current students and recent engineering school graduates to the FCC and into the forefront of the technology and communications fields. The digital revolution is rapidly transforming virtually every aspect of American life, said FCC Chairman Ajit Pai, and it's changing the FCC's work too. Many of the issues we confront today are technically complex. That makes it all the more important to bring the best engineering talent to the Commission. The Commission is seeking new engineering talent to work on cutting-edge issues in the communications and high-tech arenas. The FCC is offering an opportunity for individuals to gain public sector experience through a 1-year career development program, after which honors program engineers would be eligible for consideration for continued employment at the FCC. The FCC will review many facets of a candidate's background, including academic achievement, technical skills, engineering, and extracurricular activities, as well as demonstrated interest in government service and/or the communications sector. Interested individuals should review the recruitment announcement and apply online.
The Radio Club of America, or RCA, not to be confused with the electronics company, has announced a new endowment, the Howard VE2 AED and Michelin KM6FOH Rosen Fund, which will be dedicated solely to the support of RCA operations, the announcement said. The Rosens are longtime RCA members. It's an absolute pleasure to support this club of very special members, said Howard Rosen. RCA is a hidden gem. According to RCA President Tim Duffy, K3LR, the Rosens were inspired to create the fund after attending the 2017 RCA Awards Banquet in Pittsburgh. This endowment will make critical differences in how we quickly progress with our many initiatives for young people, young wireless professionals, and those in established careers, Duffy said. We encourage any member who's impressed with the operations of the club to make a tax-deductible donation earmarked to sustaining operations. Donations to support our day-to-day operations are critical to our future as an organization. For more information, visit the Radio Club of America website.
CW enthusiast Ken Carr, NG2H, is joining the VP6D Ducey Island de-expedition, set to take place October 20th through November 3rd, 2018. Karn is an alumnus of the VKO-EK Heard Island de-expedition in 2016. First licensed in 1955, he credits amateur radio for launching his interests in science, engineering, and oceanography. Carr is retired from the U.S. Navy, where his assignments included commanding two fast-attack nuclear submarines and serving as the senior member of the Navy's Atlantic Fleet Operational Reactor Safeguards Examinations Team. In what may be a de-expedition first, the VP-6D team will inherit the Ellicraft gear that is to be used for the KH-1, KH-7Z operation on Baker Island in June and July. From Baker, the gear will first be checked out in California and then shipped to New Zealand to load onto the Braveheart for the voyage to Ducey Island. VP-6D will concentrate on SSB and CW on 20 meters to hand out all-time new ones. When propagation sags, the VP-6D team will also take advantage of FT-8 for those who have never worked Ducey Island.
2017 ARRL November Sweepstakes CW results are now available. The results of the 2017 ARRL November Sweepstakes CW have been posted on the ARRL website. Go to the Contest Results Articles page and scroll down. Click on 2017 Contest Results and then to November Sweepstakes CW. The full results database is available. Another item that is now available on the ARRL website is the 2017 DXCC Yearbook. The DXCC Yearbook includes the 2017 annual list, as well as the 2017 Clinton B. DeSoto Challenge top scorers. Go to www.arrl.org/DXCC and look for the 2017 DXCC Yearbook tab. Click the icon and you can view and save your own copy of the yearbook in PDF format.
You're listening to North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine of the air. We are This Week in Amateur Radio, distributed worldwide at twiar.net.
And finally this week, a quick look at the FCC Enforcement Bureau in action. A few days after taking significant action on two alleged pirate radio stations in the Boston area, the Federal Communications Commission continued to call out alleged pirates for unlicensed operation. The last big action happened on March 26th, when representatives from the U.S. Marshals Service, the Boston Police Department, and the FCC seized the broadcasting equipment from two stations in Dorchester, Massachusetts. More actions came down soon after, including notices of unlicensed operation for three alleged pirate operations in Brooklyn. One to a business known as Parkesh 1718 LLC that was allegedly operating 105.7 MHz, and one to 108 Field Place Realty LLC that was allegedly operating on 99.3 MHz. A third notice was sent to Jean-Claude Michael of Brooklyn, who was allegedly operating on a frequency that was already familiar to enforcement agents. An unauthorized station had previously been operating on 90.9 MHz from Nordstrom Ave. Using direction-finding techniques, agents again determined that an unauthorized signal was allegedly emanating from Michael's residence on that same frequency. In addition, agents sent a letter to Angel Rigoberto for allegedly operating an unlicensed station on 90.5 in Newark, New Jersey. Down south, enforcement agents in Miami took a backyard tour and met up with Jerome Molter at his residence on Northeast 149th Street in Miami. Agents allegedly observed an FM transmitting antenna mounted in a tree in the backyard with an antenna coaxial cable leading from the antenna into a small lock cabinet at the back of the house. A transmitter was allegedly found there as well, the Bureau said, which was allegedly used to operate on a frequency of 90.1 MHz. And in Fayetteville, North Carolina, agents from the Atlanta office responded to a complaint of an allegedly unlicensed FM station operating on the frequency 87.9 MHz in this city. Using direction-finding techniques, agents discovered that radio signals were allegedly emanating on 87.9 MHz from a residence on Clifford Ave that is associated with Freddie Rodriguez. Each individual was warned that operation of radio transmitting equipment without authorization constitutes a violation of federal laws and were given 10 days to show that they have FCC authority to operate. In the meantime, all unauthorized broadcasts were ordered to cease.
This Week in Amateur Radio is heard on nets and repeaters all around the world and all across North America on great repeater systems like the K2IWR repeater in Cortland, New York, operated by the Skyline Amateur Radio Club on 147.18 MHz, where you can hear This Week in Amateur Radio every Tuesday night at 8 p.m.
This Week in Amateur Radio is produced by Community Video Associates Incorporated, a New York State nonprofit corporation. If you would like to become an affiliate, submit news items, send us comments about the weekly amateur radio bulletin service, or just to support us, please get in contact with us via our Facebook page. Just log into Facebook and search for the group This Week in Amateur Radio. You can also find us on Twitter at twitter.com/TWIAR. For program audio, archives, and the latest amateur radio news, visit our website at twiar.net. This Week in Amateur Radio version 2.0 is produced and distributed under a Creative Commons non-commercial share alike license. Now, for the staff of This Week in Amateur Radio, this is Jessica Bowen, KC2VWX, saying 73 until next week.